scar or a birthmark, retracing this cold heart, and now I'm all out of thread. And I don't wanna die here. Keep chasing echoes in my mind, babe, it's a fine line, and I'm so far over it. And I know it. Beneath it all, I'm so broken. Cut me out, cut it open. I can't do it anymore. I can't do it. I don't pay any mind to the deer upon the vine. Does that mean that it's not there if I can see it at all? Though the morning light will burn away all the fog the night creates, there'll still be a trace of our love left behind in the dew upon the vine.
Up a lion or frog, they're overlooking the swirls of the world, all the shifting of sands that I saw.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome today to Lake Forest Church. It is great to be with you this morning. My name is Harrison. Let's stand to our feet together as you're ready to sing and worship the God who has made every good and perfect thing. Let's worship him this morning. Talking about what it means to have a foundation for our faith. Part of the way that we do that, that we are going to continue this morning, is by grounding ourselves in a statement of faith that has been part of the church for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. So let's ground ourselves in this truth of this confession this morning. This is the Apostles' Creed. Will you make this your confession with me? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. God, we thank you for your love for us that we see on display all around as we start to look for it. And as you start to reveal yourself to us, I pray that, God, that you would be lifted up today as we worship you, as we sing truth of who you are. God, may we root ourselves in you. We worship you today in spirit and in truth and in the name of Jesus. Amen. You can have a seat.
What's up? Good morning, Lake Forest. My name is Jeff. I'm one of the pastors. And if this is your first week with us, it's important that you know that here at Lake Forest, we love people as they discover and live out their role in God's story. And everyone has a role. So I hope that you feel as welcome as you are. On your way in, you should have got a card that looks a little something like this. You'll find on this front flap a bunch of useful information about us. Inside is a spot to give us some information about you, but most importantly, on the back is a place where you can let us know how we can be praying for you this week. We really would love to do that. You can write your request down there, tear off that part of the card, and either stick it in the treasure chest on your way out of the worship center, or you can wait for the jeans pocket to come around a little bit later on in the service. That jeans pocket also happens to be one of the five places that those of us who call Lake Forest home worship God by giving tithes and offerings. You may have noticed I'm not there. We're here at Dearness Gardens. Seemed appropriate to speak to you from a greenhouse, from a garden, because we're in this new series entitled Rooted. And so I'm really excited to share a couple things going on at Lake Forest that really, over the course of my life, have helped me remain rooted in my faith. Starting with Welcome 101, which is everybody's next best step. It is a 3-week class where we get to share with you as a church what we value, what we believe, and what we do. Lets us know you, lets you get to know us a little bit. We're gonna be kicking that off actually this evening at 6:30. You can go online and register, or honestly, you could just show up. Hope to see you there. Second thing I wanted to talk about was a class called Bible 101. You know, the things that I learned in seminary brought the Bible to life for me. It's one of the most impactful things in my faith, keeps me rooted in God. And so this class is designed just to share some of the methods that I learned in seminary to help scripture come alive. You can find details for that at lakeforest.org/classes. And finally, another thing that is near and dear to my heart has been formational in my relationship to God, has been serving the poor and less fortunate, brothers and sisters who may find themselves without a roof. We do a thing here called Room in the Inn. It's gonna be coming up soon in February. And we have openings still for people to prepare food, to provide rides for folks, to set up, to tear down. It's a really great opportunity to lean into your faith. We'd love for you to be able to check that out. You can find those details at lakeforest.org/go. Once again, so glad you guys are with us today. Let's continue on.
Time for me. What's up? I'm Mike. I'm lead pastor here. And apparently I was napping. Hey, we root, God grows. We root, God grows. This is what we learned last week. And if you were here last Sunday, we learned it from Jesus in Mark chapter 4 in one of his little parables. And if you don't remember those words from last week, that's my fault. I obviously did a terrible job. So would you say it with me? We root, God grows. Let's say it. We root, God grows. And we learned in Mark 4 from Jesus that spiritual growth is all grace. We root ourselves, and then he does the work of growing us. Just like salvation is 100% a work of grace, so is spiritual growth. Sorry, I also had this in my mouth. If you miss that message, it sort of sets up the series, and I hope you'll go back and catch up. So if our part is to root, and in that, every one of us last Sunday, we took a halftime since it was Super Bowl Sunday in the sermon. And we all got up and rooted a little seed in some little dirt with a little rooted sticker, and it's in our windows, many of us, a sunny window, as a symbol of our prayer to be rooted in God in the way he says that we can grow, that he will then grow us. And so we rooted in, if you would like to participate in that, I'm not sure if they were all taken, the extras, after the first service, but in our info center, I believe you can get one. So I rooted mine, and man, it's been a whole week. It hasn't grown yet. Forget that stupid spiritual growth stuff, man. It didn't happen instantly. I don't need that. That's not how spiritual growth works. And that's why Jesus and the rest of Scripture we looked at last week compares our spiritual growth to that of an oak tree planted by streams of water. It doesn't happen instantly. We understand that if we root ourselves in God and God's Word and in the church, below the ground, then, God is always growing us into missional disciples of Jesus as we stay rooted in Him, even when it's a season of winter, like February, and we don't see any above-ground growth. He's always working. Week two is today, is to learn how to be rooted. Last week was rooted in worship. This week is rooted in Jesus-centered community. And it's part two of the way that we summarize here at Lake Forest, the Bible's discussions of how to grow as a disciple, or the four environments every disciple of Jesus needs to be in order to grow. And I'll put this on screen. You've noticed, if you've been around here very long, even our e-notes use this schematic. It's discover, belong, share, and go. Would you say that with me? Discover, belong, share, and go. And here's what we mean by that. We're summarizing a lot of the New Testament. To discover more about God, the Son, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit through God's Word and weekly worship right here. That was last week. We belong in Jesus-centered community that's committed, it's regular, and in that community, we study the Scriptures together, we care for one another, we bear one another's burdens, pray for one another, serve one another, and go on mission together. That's where the one another's of the New Testament really happen, is belonging, small group community. We share our time, talents, and treasure in our church to help other people grow spiritually, and we go, as God calls us, on God's mission of love to the world, near and far, to people like us or not like us, to people hungry for God or people hungry for food. And usually we each kind of find our own calling in God's mission. But this morning, I'm going to talk about Christ-centered community, belonging in specific small groups of other followers of Christians together. And this is a measurable thing. You either belong or you don't, in an ongoing Christian community. At Lake Forest, it's either a community group, an ongoing one, or a remix group if you're a middle or high schooler. Those groups are super cool. A men's group, a women's group, or a small mentoring group, some kind of group. You're either rooted in Jesus-centered community that's committed and regular, committed and consistent, or not. This isn't a question of what do you believe, because the Bible teaches this super clear. Jesus modeled it. He did life together with his closest 12. The New Testament models it in Acts chapter 2. They met together in homes for prayer and food and digging into the Scriptures, the apostles' teaching. So it's not a question, do you believe this or not? The question is, are you rooted or not in ongoing, consistent, committed Christian community? And As I thought about this, teaching on this, I'm like, man, I've given about 5,500 sermons on the biblical rationale for Christ-centered community. And yet a whole lot of those who follow Christ are not rooted in Christian community. And I started thinking about, why is that? And I realized there's a big but in the middle of the call to do life together. And that big but is this: church hurts. Church hurts. In my conversations with people, the number one reason people tell me they opt out of either weekly worship like this, or they may be in worship like this but remain on the fringes, the main reason that I know of people who are Christians or those inquiring into the faith who opt out of Christian community is because church hurts. And I'm speaking of the many walking wounded in the body of Christ who have been hurt by other Christians. People have been hit by the betrayal of a believer. Church hurts to be part of it. It just flat out does. I'm telling you this from experience and from listening to you over the years. And this is many of you in this room worshiping on Facebook Live or online. We're glad you're here with us. Many in this room, you've been grievously wounded in the past by a Christian. Maybe it was a relationship in your church, maybe in this church. Maybe it was at work, somebody who's famously a Christian, and they did something to hurt you. Maybe it was a Christian neighbor, or maybe you grew up in a home and you were wounded grievously by a professing Christian parent. And you'll never be the same. It's a deep wound. You'll suffer with this for the rest of your life. And maybe some of you therefore vowed, I can't trust church, or certainly not church people. I can go and be anonymous. And maybe it's kind of a miracle that some of you are here today. I'm so glad you are. I think you're here for a specific reason. And some of us decide, man, I'm going to lick my wounds and live with this pain the rest of my life. And when we do that, pain turns into bitterness. And therefore, it's our wall of resistance about being involved in church, because church hurts. It does. I met recently with a young couple who are new here at Lake Forest, and they just made an appointment to get to know me since I'm their pastor. I love it when you do that, by the way. That really honors me. I just love it. So please, that's a joy for me to know the scrimmage line of more people's lives at Lake Forest. So we're sitting down in my office, and they're like, and I said, well, have you been involved in a church, you know, before or recently? And they said, yes, years ago. And they told me a story of being hurt by a leader in that church. And it was one more time that the equipment for my profession came in handy. I talked to somebody this week at Lake Forest. His job equipment, his work equipment, is a bulldozer and a hard hat. Mine is a big box of tissues in the middle of my coffee table in my office. And this couple needed it. They dissolved into tears talking about their hurt. And I just loved on and said, I'm so proud of you for risking church again. How can we help you connect? I was with a former pastor not too long ago, a friend of mine. But he now does other work, different work, and he hates his job. And as he spilled his guts to me, he said he changed careers after he was betrayed by a leader in his congregation, in his church. Holding back tears, he said, I'm in this fix because another Christian hurt me. If you're a person who understands what I mean when I say, hey, I'm proud of you for risking church today by showing up, you know what I mean when I say that, because of your own church hurts. I understand is why I say that. I've been hurt and betrayed by Christians too. And if I have a few minutes at the end of this message, I will tell you of my greatest church hurt from church people. And I bled from that wound for a long time. And yet, I've experienced healing that I want to offer to you. Because here I am today, joyfully participating in the body of Christ in a community, in a committed way. In fact, I love Christian community so much, even though I've experienced probably more church hurt than anybody in this room because of what I do. I love it so much, I'm in two community groups. Angie and I have been in the same community group with friends for a decade now, and I'm in the 20-something group. Because they let me hang out with them, and I think that's cool. It's cool for me, not for them. I'm glad you're here if you're someone who's been disillusioned about church because you were let down, especially if it was by a leader. It's one of the reasons why I'm fearful about the job that I do, and why pastors like me, we're tempted to withdraw and not really engage and do life on life, because I can hold it together and hopefully not hurt you from here. But if we're doing ministry together, I might. And that scares me because of my role in your life. And yet I risk it. And I'm proud of those of you who risk being close up in Jesus-centered community. This is what the military calls friendly fire. The flak we take from our own side that we don't expect. And this specific pain that I'm talking about was known by the subject of our January sermon series, King David of ancient biblical Israel. In fact, he writes this in Psalm 41, verse 9. Even my close friend in whom I trusted, who ate my bread, has lifted his heel against me. Then, as now in the Middle East, the worst insult you can do is lift your shoe to somebody. Now, this pain was also known by Jesus, whom we claim to follow. Check this out. In John 13, 18, Jesus once again affirms how rooted he is in his scripture, which is what we call the Old Testament. He quotes David to express his own experience of this. He who ate my bread has lifted his heel against me. So many of us here have experienced church hurts, and we see that King David and Jesus experienced it too. So the question is, what do we do with church hurts? Do we deroot from Christian community, or do we reroot? And the question is not, how do we stop church hurts? For anybody who's a parent, were you fool enough at one point early on in your child's life to go, man, how can we stop this child's sinful nature from coming out so that they're never imperfect again? That's dumb. It's not going to happen. As long as we are imperfect people until Jesus comes again, church hurt will happen. The question is, what do we do with it? And one person puts the question this way, will I remain a victim, and I'm doing that to myself, or will I move to being a victor with Christ, ultimately symbolized by being rerooted in consistent, committed Christian community? That would be the symbol of it, but I want to talk about the process of it. What was the name of that place? Dearness was kind enough to give us this plant, which is super cool. And this is a Christian, rooted in community and in weekly worship. I'm growing, I'm happy. And then conflict happens. And they're like, man, that ain't cool. Hypocrites. Can't trust Christians. What they say about Jesus, and they don't act like him at all. I know what it sounds like. Man, I'm going to reroot from Christian community. I'm going to get myself out of that soil. If this tree stays right here, it's a lime tree, by the way, and I have gloves on because who knew lime trees have thorns? If this tree stays de-rooted from this soil, will it grow? I know it's a dumb, obvious question. You're like, ask me something hard, like the square root of 552. But it's an easy question. Will this grow de-rooted, yes or no? No, it will not. This is the picture of a Christian who de-roots and does it to themselves and takes at least a quarter of the spiritual growth that God offers you in Christian community. It's at least a quarter. In our spiritual growth strategy, we call it one of the four. It's at least a quarter of all the grace, all the growth God wants for you as you stay rooted in Christian community and live through that. And if you were hurt, you were a victim of that moment. That's true. But if we deroot, there's a full, whole mess of spiritual growth that gets stuck right there. And if you stay derooted from Christian community, you're still stuck. And that has you. There's no other way to grow a big part of your spiritual life but in Christian community. There are other ways to grow, but there are things that God wants to give you that are only found at these GPS coordinates of Christian community. And being a victim's not a good way to live, even though you were victimized, because the hurt becomes a hang-up and spiritual growth gets stuck when the roots are outside of the rich soil of Christian community. Maybe you're someone who's been around. I have people tell me, I worship online because church people scare me. They're thinking about you, Nico, probably. I'm teasing. Church people scare me. I can't risk it. There are others of you who do risk being in worship, but you stay on the fringe. And you know you do, and you know why you do. I'd love for you to risk it again. Committed, consistent, Christ-centered community around scripture study, loving one another well, and going on mission together. So this is what I wonder. How many here today are living their faith lives uprooted from Christ-centered community? And you either are or you aren't. And so I'm just asking that question as your pastor, just so you answer it for yourself. When the doctor asks you a question, it's so that you know the truth about your condition. But there's another answer. There's a way to healing. But you're going to have to get ready and get gear up because it will involve another kind of pain. It's painful to heal from church hurt. It's going to involve the pain of Christ's cross. But when we go through that cross and carry it, his cross will bring resurrection, and the new life he brings will also make the roots in the tree start growing again into what Jesus, he painted a picture of your future last week, if you remember, into an oak of righteousness. Now, a healthy church is not a church without conflict. That's why there's always going to be church hurts. That's fake if there's no conflict in a Christian community. People are not actually being themselves if that's the case. But a healthy church deals with conflict forthrightly, biblically, and we look each other in the eye. And we deal with it. And we forgive. Forgiveness doesn't mean you have to be best friends with that person. There's people who've forgiven me and I've forgiven them. We don't have to hang out. But the forgiveness really matters a lot to be able to move on. Every year, and today I'm inviting you again to root yourself in a community group, a men's or women's group, a remix group. I'm not inviting you to something that I think is a Disneyland of relationships where everything's happy and curated. It's a happy church after all. It's a happy church. I'm not inviting you to that. I have no illusions about Christian community. I know that I'm inviting you to commit to growing through the joy and friendship and the conflict of Christ-centered community. If you're a leader in here, the higher level leader you are, the more you've learned that conflict is a generative tool when handled skillfully in the hand of a leader. And this is true when it comes to God's scalpel in our lives to grow us spiritually. So let's apply God's word to church hurts. For any of you believers hurt by other believers, maybe you've been hurt, this will apply equally if you've been hurt by loved ones, or maybe just feeling betrayed by life. We're going to learn how to move from victim to victor in three drastic steps that we must take. This is the way of Jesus. And by the way, before I give you the first point, I want you to know that my main three points today are from a pastor known as named Michael Milton. He's currently the president of Reformed Theological Seminary in Charlotte. As I was researching this subject and knew what I wanted to teach today, his writing on this subject blew me away because it's remarkably similar to what I talk about with people who come to me in my office. It's remarkably similar to the process I've gone through myself, but he says it better and clearer. So you're welcome that I'm willing to not always be original, because you heard about the person who insisted on always being original. You can be original. Or I want to be original or nothing. And if you're only original, then sometimes you got nothing. So I want to lean into his counsel today and use his words for these main points. The way of Jesus when church hurts. Those are my words, actually. Number one, take up your cross. Matthew 16:24, will you read this aloud with me together? Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me." This is hard language. Let's read it again, American Christians. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me." Friends, you can, I mean this from the bottom of my heart, you can allow every sorrow, every act of treachery, every act of betrayal to become for you a point of identification with Christ and greater conformity to him. The worst slander that ever happened to me behind my back from a person very close to me hurt me deeply some years back. It hurt me mostly because it cost me some friends and it cost me a chunk of my public reputation. That hurt. And after I was able to forgive that person, what was most redemptive to me was learning to identify not as a victim, but identifying with Jesus, who was misunderstood, falsely accused, and tortured because of betrayal in his life. And I came to this recognition on the elliptical machine in the gym one day. Who am I but Jesus' servant? He is the greater, I am the lesser. I will identify with Jesus and receive his compassionate identification with me in my own church hurt. In this cross of betrayal I'm bearing, with far less significant consequences in my life than Jesus bore because of his cross. And so how do you move from being hurt to rejoicing again and rerooting in community? The answer, first, we take up your cross. It's not an easy answer, but it's the necessary one. And this is the first step to being able to follow Jesus and reroot yourself in community. This is what Jesus commanded us to do. And at the same moment when he said, take up your cross daily and follow me, his next sentence was this: for whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. And the person who's hurt and not moving on to embrace that pain as a means for God to do something in your life, that is when you or I are stuck. And the reason, when I hold on to a church hurt, is I'm choosing to not deny myself in the way of Jesus and take up my cross. Because when I hold on to my hurt, then the very thing I'm doing is wanting to feed self and not lose myself for Christ's sake. But I'm focused on my rights. They hurt me. They should do this. This is about me. I need to be justified. I need the reputation they stole from me back. I need to be taken care of. I was offended. People didn't handle it right. But Jesus says, take up your cross, follow me, deny yourself. Whoever seeks to save his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. This is Jesus' first way of dealing with church hurts. And we often think about the cross as bearing physical pain, and it is. And we want about and Christians want to think about taking up our cross as standing for truth and taking some hits for it from the non-Christian culture. Maybe even being a martyr in the culture. And throughout church history, many have been martyrs because they have done so. But the context of the cross is betrayal and being hurt by those close to us. Think about this for Jesus. And if you or I nurture a sort of faith-based or politics values-based grievance against the culture, and you nurture this grievance or grudge all the time, whether it's against conservative or the liberal sides of culture, I don't care which one it is, but if you nurture this grievance all the time and you feel it, maybe look at whether you're doing the same in family and close relationships and church relationships when you are hurt. Are you just holding on to grievance? And then look at the cross. Jesus took up his cross of betrayal and hurt and difference of value by those who values by those close to him. Zechariah 13:6 speaks of this. The wounds I received in the house of my friends. And maybe this is the pain you feel in your heart and is where some of you are living very strongly today. Now, sadly, some people take the route of cynicism and choose to live by the words of the playwright Tennessee Williams, who wrote this: oh, we have to distrust each other. It's our only defense against betrayal. Please don't allow the triumph of cynicism in your life. God does not call us to live derooted from Christian community due to distrust. He calls us to live in faith in Christ, not because we naively trust all people. The Bible teaches don't live like a, that's foolish. It's that I trust God in all situations, and this makes life sweet, reaping his promises. It's true you may be hurt, but you're a disciple of Jesus who was betrayed, who was hurt, and you and I are no greater than Jesus. To follow Christ is to embrace the cross, to say with the scriptures, though he was the Son of God, he learned obedience through suffering. Not that we become gluttons for punishment or masochistic or desire pain or call a hurt something happy. We don't do that. But we are followers of Jesus. And to identify with him, we bring all of our heartache to him. And we find meaning in our suffering, therefore, even in betrayals, through Christ, in identification with Christ and his suffering. The Apostle Paul wrote this mystical statement in the New Testament that is in a long list of scriptures that I never claimed to understand authoritatively, but I believe it relates somehow. He writes to one of the baby churches that the church itself and Christians will somehow fill up the full measure of Christ's sufferings until he returns. In dealing with the experience of being hurt by others, to take up the cross is to stop being a victim and take the path toward becoming a victor through identification with Jesus. Think about what we're taught in the example of Joseph in Genesis chapter 50. Joseph said to them, this is his brothers who had betrayed him, do not fear, for am I in the place of God? as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today. Because famously, if you know the Bible, but I'll tell you, Joseph's brothers sold him into slavery when he was a young man in a foreign country. And in that situation, hurt badly, Joseph endured hardship. He learned how to trust God. He learned how to live as a victor, not a victim, and find God's plan for his life. And he stayed engaged with life in general. And so this statement, if you can put it back on screen, is Joseph's perspective later in life when his brothers see him again and say, Joseph, don't hurt us now that you're more powerful than us. And he says, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good to bring such and such about. And this tells us our second step. The first step in moving from victor to victim in church hurt is to take up our cross. The second step is number two, take off your crown. It's good and healing for me and you if when we are hurt, we stop pretending we are sovereign and confess the truth that only God is sovereign. It is a profound, life-changing act of submission to say, I'm not in control, but God is, and therefore find healing. Because see, if you are in control, then your crucifixion has no meaning. And then we hold hostage in our heart the person who perpetrated the hurt on us. But if God is sovereign, then the one who brought your cross is Christ himself. This is difficult language. This is where I particularly lean into this other minister. It means that like Joseph, Paul, and yes, most like Jesus, it means that therefore you and me see God sovereignly ruling in all of life to bring you to the point of crucifixion, which is meant to destroy. That's what a cross is for. God has destruction on his mind in parts of your life and mine. He intends to purge, to refine. As one Puritan writer phrased it, quote, God intends to put the gold in the fire until the last dross has drained from the metal, end quote. Jesus was crucified according to his Father's sovereign plan, and it was to his Father that he cried out in his pain. Now, when I have conversations like this in my office about church hurt, at this point, it usually gets quiet because this is difficult, uncomfortable to embrace, and yet essential. Maybe it's uncomfortable for you right now, but Joseph escaped being a victim and became a victor by naming God, not as the author of evil, but the one who can cause it to work together for good. The Apostle Paul, in his letter to the Philippians, written from jail, he does not write bitter words against the false Christian preachers in his own church or the leaders of the synagogue next door in town who slandered him and caused his imprisonment. In fact, he prays for them and says, I'm willing to give my life for them even though they betrayed me. And he did give his life because of betrayal, people close to him, in the church even. Why? Because he knew that God was in control of Paul's crucifixion. God, not humankind, is in control. Here's how the 1800s pastor Matthew Henry sums up the fact of the sovereignty of God versus church hurts or other painful things sent to us. Quote, God often brings good out of evil and promotes the designs of his providence even by the sins of man. Not that he is the author of sin, far be it from us to think so. But his infinite wisdom so overrules events that the issue that ends in his praise was at first to his dishonor, as in the putting of Christ to death. Let me speak that a little more practically. There's a well-known megachurch pastor in Texas who he's well-known for his commanding leadership style. He figured out that he was apparently bringing that style home with him to his family when he walked into his bathroom one time to find a sticky note written from his wife, and it said this: when will you stop trying to be the general manager of the universe? Any general managers of the universe in here today? If I know Lake Norman people, there's a bunch of you. And as one recovering control freak, at least in one area of my life, you know there's only one general manager of the universe, and that's good news. Because the critical prayer and coming to terms with any church hurt or family pain that's come against you, here's the critical prayer for taking off my crown. And I'll put it on screen so we can pray it together right this second. It's this: God, you are in control. What do you want me to learn? Would you just say it aloud with me? God, you are in control. What do you want me to learn? Okay, right this second, would you have in mind the church person, the family member, the coworker, the boss, whoever, who hurt you, that you have the most trouble not refilling and getting stuck? And now let's pray this again, aloud. God, you are in control. What do you want me to learn? This made all the difference in the world for me and changed my life to learn to pray this prayer in the face of church hurt. And it releases you and me to let God deal with us. It focuses your pain not on somebody who hurt you, who can't make it up to you anyway. It focuses on the God who has led you to your own cross, the God who has purification and redemption in mind in your life, whenever and wherever there's hurt. Or as the English apologist Malcolm Muggeridge once put it, every happening, great and small, is a parable whereby God speaks to us, and the art of life is to get the message. Every once in a while, I remind you that we're part of the Presbyterian stream of Christianity. Of course, I always follow that, don't I, Alan, by calling us Presbyterian with a small p, because we're quite obviously, first and foremost, big C Christians here, in unity with all believing Christians in this town and around the world. That's important to us. But one reason our pastors and elders have chosen submission to the Presbyterian Church through a denomination, so that we're submitted to an authority outside of this church, or me, is this biblical emphasis that I'll put on screen. Grasping God's sovereignty, not as a theological concept, but as an act of utter submission and childlike faith, will move you from the status of a victim to a victor in any and every hurt. The first step we took, take up our cross. The second step we take is take off our crown. But it all comes together in this third step of Jesus' way to heal church hurts, which is go to your Gethsemane. And Gethsemane is the garden where Jesus went to make peace with the pain of his cross in the moments when one of his 12 closest friends was in the act of betraying him. That moment. And Jesus predicted it. He knew it was coming. And he took his committed friends that he did life together with to Gethsemane. And for Gethsemane, for you and me, it's the place where, like Jesus, you and I come face to face with our own crucifixion in the pain and hurt in our life. And with the fact that God is in control, and this happened to me. And we come face to face with the fact that if there is to be resurrection, if there is to be new life to emerge in my life where some stuff needs to get destroyed so some new stuff that's more like Jesus can grow, there must be a crucifixion first. And if there's to be a crucifixion by the Father for your good and the good of others, then there must be Gethsemane. And here's the second prayer, the prayer for step three. Gethsemane is the moment when you say with Jesus in the words of Mark 14:36, not my will, but your will. Would you just say that aloud with me? Let's practice. Not my will, but your will. Your Gethsemane, the moment when you respond to the pain you have received from others, is the turning point. When then we can reroute into the means of grace that is Christ-centered, committed community through your church. And go forward as a walking wounded, a wounded healer. Yes, carrying a burden, but also now carrying a healing salve. And that's when the step, the fourth, final step, we reroute. We can become, the fourth step is to be rerooted in Christian community. And that is the concrete, tangible evidence that we're not faking ourselves out, that we've taken the first three steps. We can go, yeah, I do that, I know that, I like that Jesus said that. And the way we're not faking ourselves, is to actually measurably, yes or no, reroute in Christ-centered community. I've got a minute or two, so I'll tell you my deepest church hurt. I'm not speaking to you, I want you to know, out of an airy-fairy biblical theology from my mind that I just read a bunch of books. I'm speaking from the rugged plains of reality of church hurt in my own life. 21 years ago, when me and some friends founded this church in a roller skating rink 2 miles from here, the first year of this church's existence was the most joyful experience in my career, and it was the most painful. Because while it looked awesome, our little church plant was so cool, and God was doing stuff, and people came to Jesus who were previously unchurched. I was so happy, and I preached under a disco ball, which made me cool for one time in my life, like that one year. While that was happening, the entire first year, a small portion of our founding group were asking the elders of our parent church in letters and phone calls persistently to fire me due to accusations that were shocking to me. That in the summer before we launched, we had to make we made a lot of decisions about this church, the group did, and we made one decision. We're like, hey, should we take up an offering like normal churches, or should we be hippie and just have a treasure box in the back and let just people chill themselves on back there if they want to put some stuff in? And we decided to pass the jeans pocket as an evidence that it just like Jesus spent his life for us, we spend ourselves on behalf of his mission in the world. So we made that decision, but I was the tie-breaking vote. And somehow, in making that decision, it was very offensive to some folks. And so the letters to the elders of our parent church accused me of twisting scripture in that decision, being a pastor just to have power over others, lying, and a whole bunch of other stuff. And so I should be fired. And in fact, they called in Presbyterianism, we call a judicial session that I had to go before that elder board and hear all this stuff by them in front of those elders. So I had the joy of a new church and the pain of being hurt deeply by other Christians as I never had been before nor after. Now, eventually, the elders of our parent church said, that's why church plants need a parent church. That's why we do it that way. The elder said, that's crazy. Stop that. Make that go away. But the wounds were deep for me, and I was certainly not without fault in any way. But through the loving counsel of a mentor, I was led through roughly the process I just led you through, and I was able to put off being a victim, to not run from Christian community, and keep people at arm's length, and just as and remain rooted in Christian community in the church. And when I reframed it from "they hurt me, I was betrayed," when I reframed it from that to "Lord, what do you want me to learn?" It was a powerful movement of my soul that changed my life. And my mentor helped me work through the forgiveness I needed to work through. But just as important, he helped me identify aspects of my emotional life and habits in my leadership that needed to be crucified on Christ's cross in identification with him. There was some stuff in my leadership needed to die so that some new things could blossom. And it was painful. But in the resurrection on the other side, I became a leader who led just a little bit more like Jesus on the other side of Gethsemane. And so it turned out that in our first year, yes, God was building a church. God was also building a pastor who still needs to take up his cross daily and say, God, what are you teaching me in the current pain of my life? And I share this not to bring attention to myself, but to show God's faithfulness. And I want that for you. I want you to experience healing from church hurts. It's possible. And I want to see each of you grow and thrive spiritually as God grows you just quietly, gently, year by year, as you are rooted in Christ-centered community because you have identified with Christ when church hurts. Let's pray, and then we'll worship. Heavenly Father, transform all of those online or in my hearing now who have been hurt, wounded, abandoned, sinned against, betrayed. Transform us, Lord, from a victim to a victor, by trusting in your Son, Jesus, who was hurt, wounded, abandoned, betrayed, but who pronounced forgiveness from the cross. And thank you that Jesus has transformed the cross from an instrument of destruction now sent by the Father as an instrument of salvation. And him, there can be no more victims when we identify with you, only victors. And I pray, Lord, every person here will learn the joy and transformation of identification with Christ and his cross when church hurts. We now bring it to you in worship. Holy Spirit, do with us and uncover what you will. Amen.
Let's stand as we respond and sing together.
Thank you.
Son and God the Holy Spirit be yours. Go in peace. Amen.
kisses. I saw her taking a walk. The tiniest speck, just a grain in the wind. But oh, how much great in the small. The tiniest body containing the glory of heaven, angels and God. I climbed down the rock and I ran to the sand of my love. My love.
Are enough. sit with folded hands and become blind. Cause even when there is no star in sight, you'll always be my only guiding light.
Shadows of doubt stealing my sleep. I'm wearing down without any need. Tired eyes and a tangled up soul. I'm feeling lost. I keep on trying to soothe my grief, but all that's left is a borrowed belief. It's truth I need, not another cliche. Your word is my hope for a steady fate. Your mysteries are mad. Still they keep me captive.
Relationship tension, we do need to pick specifically different sides.
a scar or a birthmark retracing this cold heart, and now I'm all out of thread. And I don't wanna die here for chasing echoes in my mind. Babe, it's a fine line, and I'm so far over it. And I know beneath it all, I'm still broken. Cut me